What's good, guys? It's been a minute since I've been behind the lens with Don. Well overdue. A lot has happened over the past, I think it's been like 8 months since Don's been here with myself. So a lot to cover, a lot to update yous on. Finished up with AM clients this morning in the gym. We're getting ready to do a push session. I actually haven't done this push session as of late. This is a new meso that Alan has sent over in last week's check-in. So this will be the first time me running through this. Some exercises I have done before, some are new. So we're gonna run through the session, give some tips, some kind of setup and execution considerations for different movements. And this session, actually this week, is a de-volume week for myself off the back of the previous meso. So we're only gonna be doing kind of one working set for kind of the main pushing movements in this session. The isolation movements, I'll be doing two or three sets. And yeah, we'll get into it. Hopefully we can give some practical takeaways in this video that you can implement into your own training. And yeah, let's get into it. Okay, first up on the cards is the single arm cable Y raise. So this is actually a movement that I have actually never done before. I've done different variations of a Y raise where I'm using both arms at the same time, whether it's kind of bench supported or unsupported. We're gonna be doing this kind of unsupported with no bench. Different considerations here with the setup. We can change the setup of the cable as well as my body position to make it harder or easier at certain points of the lift. So for me, I'm gonna keep it simple and go very bottom of the cable stack. I'm gonna keep my torso relatively upright. The cable or the resistance is gonna get hardest at midpoint, and it'll get a little bit lighter as I bring that arm up overhead. So we're trying to challenge all three heads of the delt, specifically emphasizing the medial head, okay? So you'll notice that my arm is coming straight across the midline of my body, trying to lengthen the delt, the medial delt, and it's coming out and across and up, trying to get that medial delt as short as possible. So up here is where the medial delt is shortest. So I'm trying to match the cable with where my arm is moving, okay? Another thing to note, and you'll see when I'm doing it, is that I'm trying to create obviously a stable base of support. So you'll notice my foot placement. I'm trying to place all that load pretty much on that back foot driving into the ground. So we're creating an opposing force because that cable is trying to pull me back towards the cable. I'm pressing my hand against the cable and digging my foot into the ground to create a stable base to work from. So just making sure that if you don't have an external support, that you create one as best you can, especially when you're doing something that's single arm or standing up. Oh. Fuck. next up is a cable chest fly, and we're going to be focusing on it being a sternal emphasis chest fly. So we're trying to think about bringing that upper arm straight across the chest, just to obviously emphasize or focus on the sternal fibers of the chest. Okay, we're going to set up the cable to where it's roughly about shoulder height, and we're going to make sure that arm is coming straight across the chest as we execute, keeping that cable in line with my upper arm, my shoulder, my elbow, my hand, as I bring that across. Okay, so another thing to consider when doing any kind of chest fly variation, where I see people doing it wrong, is restricting movement of the shoulder as you kind of go through your range of motion. So we do not want to restrict the shoulder joint as we bring the arm across the body. In order for me to bring that arm as far across my body as possible, I need to allow that scapula to move, or the shoulder blade to move. This is kind of called scapula humeral rhythm. So in order for me to efficiently move my arm across my body, I need to allow a certain level of protraction of the scapula to fully shorten the chest. Do a few warm sets, and then we will get into kind of the talking points of this. We're working up to one working set on this. So on the main pushing movements, the first one being the Smith machine shoulder press, we're only going to do one working set. So the intensity is the same. We're still going to a zero RIR. We're going pretty much to all out failure, and obviously then moving on to the next exercise. Okay, so setup considerations for the split machine shoulder press for myself. Bench angle is going to be around roughly, like say, 70 degrees. So it's not completely upright for me to get into that kind of shoulder flex position. I don't have a great range of motion in terms of external rotation. So I need to have the bench angle a little bit back from 90 degrees. I have reverse banded the split machine. So we're slightly changing the resistance of the exercise, and it's also going to contribute to slowing that weight down and managing momentum a little bit more. And that's pretty much in terms of the setup. You'll notice that what I did previously in terms of figuring out where I'm going to stop, by just doing a movement, or you're about to do an exercise, try and just do the movement with no load or no external influence pushing you into or pulling you into a certain position. So if you're trying to figure out where to stop or how far to go with an exercise, just do the movement with no external load, maintaining that execution that you're trying to achieve and in figuring out where your end position is, using that as a reference point and then pressing up in the opposite direction. So I'm using a reference of just above my chin to stop and change direction. Okay, so on the plan, I have two working sets here with the Smith machine shoulder press. We're only doing one set because it's a devolume week. So reducing the amount of sets throughout the session, but the intensity stays the same. So I'm still taking it to a zero RIR on this set. We're gonna do one more warm-up set, the final warm-up set with the weight for two reps, and then we will go. Well, yeah, we'll see. We go 110, 105. Did 105 in the last meso, so this has been carried over into the new mesocycle. The last time I did this, I got 105 for 11, or sorry, 10. So I'm only doing one working set. This feels good. I might stick with this. We'll see. I'll decide in a second whether I'll stick with 105 for that top set, for that working set, or I might increase it to 110, we'll see. Okay, so we're gonna do our working set now. Decided to go with 110 for that working set. Need to get 10 reps, so it's a rep range of 10 to 15. Whether it's 110 or 105, the execution, the tempo stays the same. So we need to standardize that as we're going through the lift. So we do not want to rush that bottom position. The rep one should look pretty similar to that rep 10 or whatever rep I get at the end, okay? So we do not want to speed up that bottom position. I see time and time again people having great tempo initially, but when it gets to the point where it's the most difficult, they speed up, they bounce, they use momentum. We do not want to do that regardless that it's 110. Fuck you. That was 9 reps. Fuck's sake. Close. We'll get it next week. First time doing that rep range, so we'll get it next week. All good? Okay, next up is the upright chest press, Jim Echo. This is also a movement that was in my previous meso. We have one set here for 8 to 15 reps. So we'll do one more warm-up set with the weight that I'll probably use for like 2 reps, and then we'll get into that working set. You'll notice that setup-wise, handles position below the shoulder, right around my chest line. And you'll see that I have slightly just manipulated my body or my torso to be leaning back a little bit more. So it's gonna incorporate a little bit more of that lower chest, a little more of that costal fiber as well as the sternal fiber as I bring across my arm. So by manipulating my torso, by manipulating my body position, I can change what is being worked in terms of musculature of the chest. In this case, creating a slight bit more of a decline will emphasize a little bit more of that costal fiber. Also, forgot, this is banded, so it is reverse banded. And the band is obviously going to contribute to affecting or changing the resistance of where the machine is heaviest and lightest, but it's kind of slowing the weight down as it gets further away from the axis or the point in which the machine is moving from. So the band in itself is, yes, contributing to a change in resistance, but it's also slowing the weight down because it's moving really far away from the machine. It's creating a lot of momentum because it's moving at a great distance away from the machine. So that's why the band is there. Okay, final point before I get into that working set here on the upright chest press. I see this time and time again with people doing pressing movements, specifically kind of machine-based pressing movements, is restricting movement of the shoulder or the shoulder blade as you go through that range of motion. We do not want to try and lock that shoulder in place and move that arm across your body. We want the shoulder to move. We want it to allow freedom of movement there. Again, that whole scapula humeral rhythm thing. We want to create some space between, or some distance between, the shoulder and the chest, so the chest has the best kind of advantage to pull that arm across the body. I don't want that shoulder forward as I begin that press. That can then take over and allow you to use your shoulders more than your chest. So allowing retraction and returning back to its neutral position. That got really hard, really quickly. Got 8 though, but I should have got at least 1 or 2 more there. Is a incline cable chest press. So we're trying to emphasize the upper portion of the chest or the clavicular fibers of the chest. So we want to set this up in a way where our arm is moving in direction of where the fibers are running. So we're going to start low and finish high with that arm position. So you saw upstairs with that upright chest press, the arm is pretty much coming straight across the body, slightly down, where we're going to emphasize that sternal kind of costal area of the chest, the mid to lower portion of the chest. With this, we're going to try and emphasize that upper portion of the chest. I just want to say another thing after that. I'm going to make them two together. I'm just going to talk about the setup. So you'll notice with the setup, I have my bench positioned kind of behind the actual cable. So my shoulder is behind the cable is in front of me. That allows my arm to start in a low position in front of me, and I'm gonna press up, across, and finish in line with my clavicle. So I'm gonna start low, finish high. You'll notice that my upper chest is sitting on top So I have the bench at an incline where my upper fibers of my chest is on top as I drive that arm across. Okay. Okay, so you'll note that arm position below the shoulder in front, the fibers of my upper chest are running down in this direction. So I want to try and mimic my arm path with the direction in which them fibers are moving. So I'm thinking about coming up and across and trying to point my bicep towards my clavicle, specifically kind of more so the lateral two thirds of my clavicle as I come across to try and bias the upper portion of my chest as much as I can. Am I going to get some anterior delt? Yes. Am I going to get some sternal involved? Yes, but we're trying to emphasize that upper chest. Next up is a costal emphasis dip. So how we're going to bias the lower fibers of our chest is by manipulating our body position as we go through that dip, as well as changing the direction in which my arm is moving. So the difference between a tricep dominant or a tricep emphasis dip is body position as well as the direction of your arm. You'll see that your elbow is tucked by your side with a tricep emphasis dip, torso being more upright. With this, we're going to manipulate our torso by having it forward and the elbows or the arm is going to be flared out and driving down in line with my lower fibers of my chest. Okay, so next up is a superset of standing dumbbell lateral raise and lying cuff lateral raises. These two exercises complement each other very well in terms of resistance profile, so where it gets heaviest and lightest. So that dumbbell lateral raise is going to get heaviest in that top position, overloading that top position, and it's going to be quite obviously light, or there's no resistance really in that bottom position. Whereas the lateral raise, you will get some resistance at the top, but it's more so overloading that lengthened position. So it's dropping off as I get to the top. That cable is getting closer to my shoulder, dropping off and making it easier to get into that position. God. Oh. Oh, fuck. Done. So we did two tricep exercises finished. Just a supported overhead tricep extension and then a X body tricep extension or a crossover extension and to finish off. So that's pretty much it. We're going to do a little bit of a physique update, give some info on plans moving forward with competing towards the latter end of the year. And yeah, let's get into it. Enough. What's on your back?
Seven.
So, right, probably finished at 8. Okay. So I'll be back 8:30, roughly.
Okay.
Cool. Talk to you in a bit.
See you later.
Okay. Right, back home from the session. Good session. Post-workout meal. And then we're going to go into the office. Post-workout, 150 grams of cereal. I've decided to go with Crunchy Nut. Rotated between three different cereals at the minute. And then I'm going to have, which is going to be very weird and odd combination, but I'm having 170 grams of cooked chicken breast. So that doesn't sound appealing, but it works. But yeah, going to eat this, watch something random on YouTube, and then we'll get into the office and discuss plans moving forward for prep.
Chicken breast and
not together, separately. Eat this first and then have a chicken breast.
How does the chicken breast?
I used to have whey, but I can't have whey anymore because it doesn't agree with me. So I would use either a vegan protein, which I don't have, or have some sort of high biological value protein, which is a chicken. I'm going to go with chicken. If it was a rest day, I would have 400 grams of square yogurt with some granola, and I wouldn't have a chicken breast with cereal because it's not a training day. But yeah, not the most appealing choice or combination, but you gotta do what you gotta do. Okay, so update on kind of the current situation with prep. Right now we have 6 weeks left of this, roughly, of this improvement phase before we enter into prep. So I start prep on the 24th of April, the kind of last week of April. That's kind of when I start prep. It's going to be roughly a 20-week prep until the first show. First show is going to be in Alicante, in Spain. That's going to be the first show. And then following that in 2 weeks' time is going to be another show that I can't talk about. Bit of a surprise. And then the following week is going to be a show in Italy. And then the last show of the season will be in Hungary, hopefully. That is going to be the 14th. So Italy's going to be on the 7th. Of October, Hungary's gonna be on the 14th, which could be nice kind of back-to-back shows. But yeah, that show after Alicante is still a bit of a surprise. Hopefully we can talk about that soon enough. But that is the current plan as of late. It might change, we don't know. But all I need to focus on right now is kind of wrapping up and making the most of these last 6 weeks to make the most improvements before starting prep. And then once prep is starting, then it's really like head down, focused, laser focused for that first show. It's been 4 years since I've been on stage. So a lot of improvements, and this is the first time I'm going to be competing in the NPC. So a completely different challenge, completely different standard. So I'm looking forward to that. So a lot of things to look forward to over these next few months.